When I had come down this hill, I had seen this creature cross the road. It would have ripped my locked door from my truck, extracted me from my vehicle, and there wouldn't have been a damn thing I could have done about it.
This thing, I got to noticing its eyes. Its eyes was real, real evil, real sinister looking, you know, the look it was giving me.
What are you reporting?
Jesus Christ, you better...
Sir?
Deal.
Hello?
Get somebody out here.
What's going on now, sir?
That son of a bitch is about 6'9", I don't know.
Do you see him now, sir?
Yes, I'm looking right at him.
Uh-oh.
Welcome to Bigfoot Hotspot Radio, Sasquatch Chronicles. I'm your host, Wes, along with my brother, Woody, and researcher, author, and friend, William Jeffy. Let's start the show.
It's funny, I had posted that video about David Pilates. Am I saying his last name right? You say it Pilates, or how do you say it?
I don't know. I always kind of mess it up when I say it, so I'm not really sure.
Yeah.
I'm not sure that I've even heard anybody pronounce it.
Yeah, it's funny. He posted, he sent me a private message. I had posted a video on our Facebook fan page about this case I'm going to play for you here in a second. It's funny. He was saying that he sent me a private message asking me to moderate the comments. You know, go through and monitor everyone's comments, and because he felt like he was being attacked. Yeah. I went through and looked at him. You know, to be honest with you, how many times do you and I get attacked, Will, on our own Facebook page? You know what I mean?
yeah, exactly. Well, you know, what gets me is like, okay, that was from a show he did, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was a show he did with Howard Hughes, and it was the case of. Go ahead.
So it was his own comment, you know, that for whatever wording he chose to use and how he phrased the information he put out there, people make comments about it. You know, he attacks us for putting the post out, but we didn't say any of that. It was just, you just posted it and people made comments. So why the attack on us? That's usually kind of a, you know, if you're that nitpicky about something, you know, if you're that unsure of what you're saying, then you're a little defensive. You know, maybe there's something wrong with what you're saying.
I mean, people disagree with you and I all the time, Will, on our Facebook fan page. We have a lot of flute players on there that come on and they'll post different comments that Sasquatch is our buddy. You know, we're the mean guys of the Bigfoot community because, which I don't quite understand because we just have people tell their encounters. But but it's funny
we're
that
just presenting the material.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, you know, I read some of the things he said on that thread, and these guys are all tied in with this interdimensional forest friends, you know, and they defend this stuff. Now he was defending what I'm referring to as Melba Ketchum, and you know that whole thing is a huge can of worms all by its lonesome, you know, and I've said this before in the show. You know, initially, I was kind of open-minded. I even offered to assist her before I knew anything about what she was doing with that DNA study, you know, for whatever my 2 cents would be worth. And she said, okay, you know, never heard from her, which is fine. As this went on, and it wasn't just one person who told me. There were a number of people that were involved with her in that whole thing that were her pals. As this went on, it got crazier. You know, it started out with, you know, my question was, you know, about the chain of evidence and collecting the samples they use for DNA tests and contamination. And those are all very legitimate concerns. And then it went on to where she claimed she had this group habituating on one of her properties. You know, her business, the DNA business, had an F rating with the Better Business Bureau. she claimed on her properties where the Bigfoot were habituating that she was both mentally and physically raped by numerous of these beings. And then in the last thing that I heard was that they're claiming that Sasquatches have alien DNA as from space. You know, and at that point, I was done listening to any of this stuff. All a farce. It's all absolute nonsense. And I don't care how much they all push how legitimate it could be, whether it's Dave Pelias, Melba Ketchum, or any of those supporters, they're all fruitcakes.
Well, the thing with Dave is, you know, I mean, he was saying that people were attacking him like on a criminal, saying he was criminal and all this other stuff. And I went back and read all the comments. I told him, hey, if someone's out of line, I'll go through and I'll remove their comment. And I generally don't like to do that. If I got upset by, if you go to Bigfoot Hotspot Radio, our fan page on Facebook, if I got upset by every little knock at me or every little knock at you or every little knock at Shannon, I'd go nuts, man. I would be upset 24/7.
And you know, the bottom line is that people have a right to their own opinions.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
You know, and those fan pages, that's kind of a place for people to speak their minds, you know, and talk to one another and talk about various aspects of what we're doing or something else in the community. And they have every right to say that as long as they're not abusive.
Right. And that's, you know, and that's what I was trying to express to him was, hey, man, you know, if I went through and deleted every comment that upset me, I'd be deleting comments. But you're right. I mean, people have their right to their own opinion. They can post what they want as long as it's not way out of line. It's not abusive. I think a guy called us a-holes for not doing a show last week, and I left his comment there, you know. And by the way, I'll apologize to the audience for no show last weekend. We've been doing a lot of these, and I want to get to it, but we've been doing a lot of these video interviews, which are really cool. And when I play the Yowie interview, you'll kind of understand why it's kind of cool to see this on video. The guy had some hair that he had found, and he had pulled it out, and he was showing us the hair. It was the creepiest hair I've ever seen. I don't think I've ever seen hair like this before.
Yeah, it should be very interesting to the audience to see that.
Before I get to the interview with Jaime from Australia that had the Yowie encounter, and he had a pretty terrifying encounter, and I wanted you to hear this encounter, Will, and I wanted to get your take on it. But before I actually play that interview, I want to play this for you. This was on the Unexplained with Howard Hughes, and this is David Pilates. We had talked a lot about Colin Fittigay. I hope I'm pronouncing his last name right. I apologize if I'm not. But he's a football player that disappeared. And this is about a 9-minute interview. I wanted to play it for you real quick and get your take on it. This is a gentleman that disappeared in Michigan.
So this is one of those cases, Howard, where we spent a lot of time on it. And we actually got the original reports and the original photos from the sheriff's office that worked this case. This area is north of Detroit, Michigan, called Webster Township. And when you're doing this kind of work, it's really important to understand the historical background of the area. And this area, going back to the 1800s, has disappearances that we've written about before. And I'm talking about really, really unusual stuff. And it's why we don't know. It's a swampy, very thick forested area, and it's in the area of the Great Lakes, and there's been a lot of strange things that have happened around the Great Lakes in the last 300 years, and you could add Colin's case to it. A little bit about Colin. He's 6'2", 240 pounds. He was a college football quarterback. Originally, he was going to play what's called Division I. He ended up playing Division II. He had a 28-0 record in 2 years of playing, and his college coaches described him as the toughest person on the field. Not the toughest quarterback, the toughest on the field. And when he played a couple of games, he stopped his linemen that protect him in that pocket and said, you know what? you're stopping a lot of these guys and we're taking penalties for holding to make sure they don't hit me. He goes, let him hit me. He goes, it's not going to bother me. And I'm big enough. I can take care of myself. So, and the coach went over to him and said, did you say this to the lineman? And he said, yeah, I don't care. Let him hit me. They're not going to hurt me. And the coach said, he's never heard anything like that in his life. And he said, he was such an unusual guy. He wasn't afraid of anything. After college, he played briefly pros for a little while. He ended up marrying a sweetheart volleyball player. They had two kids. And for Memorial Day weekend, that's the last weekend in May in 2013, they went up to this area of Webster Township with other family members to go fishing. And this Baldwin River isn't a fast-moving river. It kind of meanders its way through a fairly flat area outside of Webster. And Colin went in alone. And he says, hey, I just want to go fishing one more time. No big deal. So they put him in the river, and the people were going to meet him at about 9:30 and pull him out. And at about 9:27, his wife receives a frantic call. And the quote was, he was being followed by two, and one of whom was 20 feet behind him. That was essentially what he said in a frantic way. He goes, he said something to him, there was no reply, and the phone immediately hung up. And his wife told law enforcement he sounded paranoid and scared. She got other calls at 9:34 and 9:36, just saying he was being followed and he was nervous. Now, 9:36, one of his best friends who went on the trip with him called and asked where he was, and he said he's not sure, and he says it's getting a little rough. I think a couple of guys are following me. Phone hung up again. And his wife asked him on one of these calls, he had an iPhone, said, hey, get the coordinates off of the iPhone. And he said, okay. And she talked him through it and was able to get him. Well, they show up at 9:30. He's not there where they were supposed to meet him. 10:37, a deputy from the area responds. He starts to take a report. And this is a small county. This isn't a high-tech, fast-moving county. This is a pretty rural, slow-moving place, you'd think. Well, this deputy did a lot of good things and a lot of smart things. One of the things he did was he contacted the cell phone company, and he asked him to ping the phone. And what that does is it gives you coordinates on where that phone is located at the time the pings hit it. And it gave them, they gave the deputy four different locations. Now, I got that report from the phone company that was in the law enforcement report. And it showed four different locations within minutes of each other, 4.37 miles apart.
Within minutes of each other. How can you yeah. Unless you're being flown or in a helicopter or a jetpack or something, you can't do that.
Exactly. It's impossible to get to those locations. And the other impossible fact when we mapped them is that each one of those locations crosses a paved road. So meaning Cullen would have easily found a road and found a house. Well, at 12:12 a.m., searchers and his family found his boat, and there was one oar missing. And again, this started a search, and it went on. And on the 27th, the day after he disappeared, it started raining, and it rained hard. As this is going on, the sheriff's, this is big news in this area. And the sheriff reports state that they got a series of calls from neighbors. And I report to people whatever the reports say. I'm not trying to screen the information. I'm not trying to push one belief over another. But one of the reports they got from a neighbor is that it was obvious to them that Cullen spooked a Bigfoot and the Bigfoot was tracking him. I don't know if it's true. That's what one of the things said. Now, on the 28th, his body was found, like you said, face down. Now, I got the crime scene photos on that, and they're gory. And gory meaning there was no obvious sign of trauma to his body. When they rolled him over, he was bleeding out of his nose, which is fairly common. But the unusual part to me is I'm a fisherman, and I wear waders all the time. And when you wear waders, they're like a plastic outer lining that goes up over your legs, sometimes goes over your waist. And the supports for the waders crisscross over your back and go over your shoulders. And on Collins, three of us looked at this and said, hey, this is weird. The straps on his back were twisted, almost as though somebody grabbed him from the these and twisted him as they lowered him to the ground. Because you don't want that twisted feeling on your back, it's uncomfortable. I can't believe any fisherman would walk around with that purposely. Now, they sent Cullen's body to two different coroners. One was a university. And the original coroner said, well, they found some small amounts of prescription drug in his system, and that could have caused him to regurgitate and choke, but that wasn't a cause of death. And the bottom line was, they couldn't figure out a cause of death, Cullen's. And the New York Times wrote a lengthy article about Cullen for a variety of reasons. Number one, he was a big star, big name person, and he disappeared for 2 days, and they find his body in the middle of this area where they were getting these pings. But nobody wants to address a few key points. First of all, there was no cause of death. Number two, he reported being followed. I don't think people make that stuff up. And he reported being followed for, you know, a lengthy period of time. And to find him face down like they did in the area of these pings, no one wants to address how he was able to move 4+ miles in an area of super thick woods, rivers. How was he able to traverse this? And the other part that nobody has done, and even we haven't done it, is reach out to his family. And I want, on these kind of things, I really want time as the ultimate healer before we approach his wife and ask her and explain to her what we found, because I don't think anybody ever has.
Good Lord. And so it's in a book for her to read about if she wants to, but the sad fact of the matter is that a case like that needs to be picked up and run with by somebody, because there are too many inexplicable facets to it, and nobody's doing that. I think that's the thing that I find most shocking. It's a terrifying case, and he was obviously a big and well-liked guy. What an awful, awful thing to have to park like that. I don't know, if I was the wife or a family member, it would torment you day and night, wouldn't it?
I think it would for me. But so you and I, and the people out there that have read the books, have a pretty good understanding that this is happening in many parts of the world right now. And to the common person that has no visibility to this, this is a one-time issue. Yeah, they could say, well, you know, maybe Cullen had issues, he had problems, he had some anxiety in his life, and this is, it just got to a point he was, maybe had mental illness, even though no one claims that. And he made all this stuff up, and he just died. And, you know, this, in your mind, you're saying, well, this happens, and you're trying to reconcile it using that common sense approach.
Well, it seems, Dave, that people are extrapolating a lot of stuff, but not looking at the evidence that they can find. And the evidence is, look at the way that those waders, the supports for them, were twisted, and look at those the readings from his cell phone. And that couldn't have happened. Those are the things they should be looking at, not trying to speculate whether he, you know, had any issues of any kind. It seems weird. It seems like someone somewhere wants to try to find some kind of explanation so we can close the book on this.
I gave a talk in 2012 in front of the biggest search and rescue organization in the world, NASA. And there were search and rescue people from all over the world there, and it was a huge, huge event. At the end of my talk, there was a line of people going outside the room and wanted to talk to me about what I'd stated. And again, I just stated overall what we found, some of the extreme cases that we found, and the commonalities. And there was two troopers from Alaska State Troopers that were there. And then in the middle of the presentation, they stood up and they said, you know, they looked around the room and they were probably the bravest people there. They said, Dave, you're saying things that we all know, but nobody wants to talk about. And they said in Alaska that each of these guys had been on over 100 search and rescues, and many of these had the elements that I explained, and they knew that something was going on, but they couldn't explain it.
And one of the things that we may say is that Bigfoot exists, but nobody really wants to acknowledge that fact. And that's just one element of the stories that you tell.
Oh, sure. And I think that when you get these people that have experienced this time after time, and I have many letters from search and rescue people that say, yeah, Dave, this happened to us, and blah, blah, blah. Nobody wants to talk about it. Nobody wants to explain it. Nobody wants to do follow-up on it.
Interesting case. What'd you think, Will?
Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, I had some people send me that article a few months ago. The one thing you didn't mention to me, you talked about some different particulars. You know, it took the coroners 3 months to come up with their conclusion was that he drowned. You know, the question was, why would it take them that long to come up with a conclusion to drown? That's something that's fairly common, and they would know that right away. And that particular situation, he said, was like a unique one. It really isn't. There was another case very similar, and the similar here in California recently, where there were a couple of firefighters at camping. One got up in the middle of the night, the dog was going crazy, and he took off barefoot. His body was found 1,200 feet in elevation above the campsite. And the similarity, why I say that case wasn't unique with the football player, was the fact that police didn't mention that his body was found with brush over it. And the case of the firefighter was found covered with brush. So there is something going on. I don't know about it. You talked about the background of that area, you know, with the disappearances and things, weird things, you know, lots of weird things go on all over the place, you know, were they directly Sasquatch related or not? You know, you don't want to jump to conclusions on anything. You know, you can speculate all kinds of things can happen, but without any sort of direct chain of events or witness or evidence or something linking the two, I wouldn't, you know, just because somebody disappears and they're never found again, I wouldn't directly link a Sasquatch to that unless there was, you know, something a little more tangible to it.
Yeah, good point. Strange, nonetheless, though.
Very strange. But, you know, in this case, it could very well have been one. I think the one here in California may have been also because of that one detail with the brush being piled on. So, I mean, we don't know. We heard Bob Garrett talk about that in Texas also.
Yeah, it's interesting. The river that David had mentioned in the video I'd posted on our Facebook fan page, I had put in pictures of that river. And it's not really a fast-moving river, man. It's pretty shallow. You know, it kind of reminds me of the Clacks River that we have over in Oregon. It's real, you know, that they claim all these people tend to drown in.
Not one that's likely to be somebody drowned in.
Yeah, not likely to be.
Oh, I was just going to make a comment about the time frame that he mentioned. You know, going miles in just minutes. Now, even as fast as a Sasquatch is, I kind of have a problem with that.
Yeah, that seemed really fast to me. What was it, 4.7
yeah,
miles?
Yeah, a little too quickly. Yeah, it just doesn't sound right.
That's a pretty heavily wooded area, too, where he disappeared.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, I wanted to jump ahead to this interview that we did with Jaime from Australia. And I know you're working at the time, Will, but I wanted you to hear this interview. And again, I'll be posting this video on our Facebook fan page under Bigfoot Hotspot Radio. Listen to this interview. Jaime sure pulls out a lot of details a lot of little things that we've heard of in the past, but I wanted to get your take on it, Will. But we're speaking with Jaime from Australia, who had, I want to say, a couple of Yowie encounters, both Class A, Class B type sightings. But go ahead, Jaime, take it away and tell us about the first time you had an encounter.
The first time I had was late November 2013, which is only recently. We go up to a national park, get there about 5 in the afternoon, and we always cook a barbecue. But this particular day, I was there by myself because my mate that comes with me couldn't make it. So I'm there, I cooked the barbecue, and I'm eating my hamburger. And it's on top of a lookout, on top of a ridge area. And I could hear these voices down in the valley below talking really fast, but I couldn't understand it. I've called out to let whoever it was down there know I was there because they do have hunters in there shooting feral pigs from time to time. As soon as I yelled out, they just went silent and the whole bush, everything just stopped. Like, it was just absolute silence. About an hour and a half later goes on, and there's just absolutely no noise whatsoever. And then by this time, it's getting dark because it's around 7 o'clock. By this time, I get out my spotlight, and I'm just looking around, and then I spot some yellow eye shine probably 50, 60 metres down in the gully below in the trees and that. So I'm just standing there with my spotlight right on it, and this thing, it's just staring straight back at me. So I'm just holding my light on it to try and catch it move or blink, and then nothing. So this went on for a good 30 minutes, me just standing there with my light straight on these eyes. So then I do a full circle scan, and I've turned around, and then I've looked up down the road, and there's this big tree, and that's when I've seen this thing just standing there by the tree out in the open. And this thing was massive. It stopped me dead in my tracks. I just froze. So I'm standing there, and I'm holding my light right on this thing, and it was huge. It was really big, hairy, like, wasn't short hair. It was real long, shaggy looking, browny, reddy, sort of a grey tinge to it. So I'm standing there, and I shine the light up and down this thing, and it just stood there, and just, I was just dumbfounded, like, I didn't know what to make of it. So I'm just standing there with my light on it, and then I've gone to do another 360 degree scan, and then I noticed there was another set of eyes, but smaller compared to the first set, in the same spot where I'd seen them previously. And then I've gone back to where the thing was standing, and it was gone. So then I've sort of, about 3 or 5 seconds goes past, and then I hear thump, 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 and then this almighty howl. It was so long and loud, I could feel it. But it wasn't a howl of thump. It was like the letter R being held really, really long. And then I was in shock, basically. I didn't know what to make of it, and I just threw all my stuff in the back of the car, and I started to drive off down the road. And I was actually shaking because I think I was in a bit of shock because I was there by myself. And then about 100 metres down the road, it's a really rocky terrain, and I'm just going probably 20 kilometres an hour because it's an off-road track. And I felt something sort of shunt, like push the back of the car. And I touched my brakes so I could see the red lights behind me, and I couldn't see any of them. So I just kept going, and I thought, I'm not getting out to have a look because I'm by myself, and I've already heard something that I can't explain, and I've seen this, and I'm just thinking, there's no way that anyone is going to believe me. I tried to tell my wife and kids the next day, and they're sort of all laughing at me, yeah, sure, Dad, whatever. And
Jaime, how many creatures do you think were around you that night? Just looking back, I mean, just a rough estimate.
Well, I'd say there was two. There was the big one that I seen, and then there was another set of eyes, but they were smaller compared to the first set of eyes in the same spot.
Now, when you shone the light on that one that was by the tree, how big do you think the creature was?
Well, we've actually been back to the same spot during the day, and my mate Louis, he's 6 foot tall, and we estimate to where the eyes were, it was 7.5 feet, just to where the eyes were.
Oh, wow.
Because where we stand, it's up on top of the hill, and you're looking down the gully. So whatever it was big, and I've had people tell me it was a cow, because there is cows running through the bush there. There's wild horses, there's wild dogs, there's dingoes, pigs. And I keep saying to everyone, unless a horse or a cow can stand on its hind legs, that's what the height of this thing was.
And the one incident with the car, it was trying to pull the car as you were driving, or it was pushing the car as you were driving slowly back through there?
It just felt like something come up behind the car and just sort of went a slight shunt on the back of the car.
Wow.
And then the next time I went up there, I took my son because he didn't believe me. And I said, well, if you don't believe me, come with me. And he did. Same thing again. We get there, have a barbecue, wait for it to get dark, and then we get the lights out and we start looking around. He spotted it first. He says, Dad, there's something down in that bush with yellow eyes looking at me. And I said, don't worry, mate. That's what we've been talking about, and that's what I want to show you so you can tell people that you've seen it as well as me. And then he got freaked out straight away. And then we're looking around, and then there's another set up on top of the hill. Like, the car's in the middle. There's one set down the hill, and there's another set up the hill standing there just looking at us. And then we could smell this bad smell all of a sudden. It was just like something was dead. It just wafted past, and then was gone. We stayed there for about 40 minutes. And then he just said, Dad, I want to go home because this is too freaky. And I said, well, fair enough, mate. You've seen it, so you can tell people. And to get out of there back to the main road, it's another 40-minute drive through the national park. And we get probably halfway, and I noticed that my son's sitting really stiff in his seat, and he's not moving. And I said to him, what's wrong? And he didn't answer me. And then when we got to the bottom of the park, once we were driving out of the national park, he turns to me and says, Dad, couldn't you hear that thing running in the car in the bush beside us? He goes, I could hear it breathing. He goes, I didn't tell you because you would stop and want to get out and have a look. I didn't hear it. I didn't see it, but that's exactly what my son told me. And that just absolutely blew me away. I thought.
And was it at night? You guys were driving?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, it's always about 10:30, 11 o'clock at night is when we leave. Because we usually get there around 4 in the afternoon and then we stay because it gets really cold up there. So we don't like to stay too long.
And this happened shortly after dark? At least the last two incidents were shortly after dark?
Every time after dark, probably the sun will go down and then because it's a really dense treed area up there. So as soon as the sun goes down, it gets dark really quick. And then always you see the eyes looking at you.
And how busy is this national park? If the weather is nice, is it a busy place?
During the day, you can get a lot of people up there. Like, I went up there through the day by myself to have a look around. I counted there was 15 cars that went past me. But during the night, we've only ever had one other car come up there. And that's it. There's no one else that goes up there at night except us.
And have you heard other reports of incidents up there, people seeing things?
There has been other reports in the region, but not in that particular spot. I've heard from anywhere else. I've asked around, and everyone thinks I'm crazy.
I'm kind of curious. Aren't you worried a little bit, Jaime, going up there? Since you can't carry a gun in Australia, you can't go up there with a gun?
No, we haven't had any signs of aggression whatsoever, but you do feel nervous, and I do feel anxious, especially when I go there by myself. But because no one wants to come with you, like, I've only got one mate that will come, but he's a single parent, so there's only certain times he can come. Where we've seen it stand, there's a barbed wire fence, and there's a trackway where something goes through there quite often. And there's a lot of pushed over small trees that are snapped probably at my eye height and pointed back. And that all these trees are pointing in the direction exactly where we stand. And the same spot where this trail is, it crosses an old barbed wire fence. And we actually found hair, which was about 200 millimeters long. And it was the same color as the thing that I've seen. There was black, there was orangey, red, and gray color in these hair samples that we pulled off the fence.
What did you do with the hair?
I've got it here. Can you see it?
A little bit, yeah. Oh, it's really dark, isn't it?
It's really dark, and it's like...
So I want to stop the interview right there. And I posted that on our Facebook fan page under Bigfoot Radio. I really wish our her normal website was up. It'll be up here shortly. But what he actually done, Will, is he had pulled out this hair in the way, and I'll describe it for the listeners. It's kind of a reddish, brownish hair, about a foot long. It kind of reminds me of a pubic hair. It's real stringy. It's real wiry. Just an, and he had several of them, but it's just an odd hair, man. I don't think I've ever seen hair like this before.
You know, the two Sasquatches that I saw up close, and we were talking earlier, how, you know, I mentioned that I think a lot of people will, there are particular things in an encounter that will sort of stick out in your mind, you know, as opposed to other things. And it might not be what the average person would think. To me, for my own, was I noticed a lot of detail about the hair. And what he describes is a lot like what I saw on those two creatures. So, and everything he said was very, very characteristics, all the particulars of the encounters we have in this country.
Yeah, it was interesting about him talking about bumping his car on his way down.
You know, I actually had something similar that happened years ago like that. A friend and I were up in an area not far outside of Fort Lewis where a lot of sightings happen. We're pretty sure, we don't know, well, actually we did, there were hand marks in the dust where one had actually grabbed the back of the car and sort of let go when we decided to take off. But, you know, so occasionally they will bump cars, push cars, grab cars. That's not uncharacteristic.
Yeah, it's interesting. I will, here, let me play the, let me continue with the interview here.
Wow.
And that's the length of it.
Here, hold it up one more time.
Yeah, hold it up.
I'm going to turn the camera on you. Here, hang on 1 second. Go ahead and hold it up a little higher, Jaime.
That's what we call it off the fence, exactly where I was saying it's standing.
Oh, my goodness. That's some really long hair, Jaime.
I know. And I sent some samples to a fellow researcher here in Australia, and he looked at it under the microscope, and he said it didn't match anything that he could find on his database that he's cross-examined. He said, but it looked familiar to cattle hair, that it had human characteristics. And I sent him a message back, and he never got back to me because I didn't understand what he meant by that. I'm just going to hang on to it and hopefully try and get someone else to look at it.
I'm kind of curious, when you got the hair off of the fence, the barbed wire fence, I want to ask you a question about the barbed wire fence. Did you notice any spots in that fence to where it looked like something had propped it open to either go through the barbed wire fence, or did you notice any debris on top of the barbed wire fence, like it was easier to get over it?
When we first went there, it was an old barbed wire fence, and it was still up. And then when we went back, I think like a month later, the fence had been pushed totally down to the ground level, and there was a big tree that had looked like had either fallen over the fence line, but you could see there had been a lot of something going through because all the grass was flat. You could see the track perfectly on where whatever was going through there.
What did the tracks look like, Jaime?
Just the ground was flat. It wasn't cattle because when the cattle go through, you'll see like the hoof marks on the ground. It was just flat. There was no sort of animal marks or anything. The ground was just flat.
So nothing really defined?
No footprints or
anything there?
No. The second time we went up there, before I had my sighting, we did find a footprint. And it was, we didn't have a tape, so we just, it was about 15, 16 inches long. And it was about 6.5 inches across the top of the foot.
Mm.
But because the ground's so hard up there, we got there just after it rained, and all the soft dirt on top, you'd see the imprint on top of the dirt. And then we walked up the road back to where we always stand, and we seen smaller ones, which looked like the size of a 10-year-old kid. All bare footprints.
Jaime, what's the water situation around that park? Is there any lakes or streams?
There's plenty of water. There's a stream that runs through the whole park, and there's probably three or four big dams all the way up along the track, because it used to be an old logging road that they used to cut all the timber down up there.
And that logging road is still not very overgrown at all? Like, it'd still be easy to walk down for the most part?
Oh, the road that we drive to get where we get is actually on the logging road.
Oh, that's the logging, okay.
Yeah. And it runs right through over the range and goes right out west.
Yeah, it's kind of a central Washington, Shannon. It's kind of, I know when you think Australia, I was going to say we as Americans, maybe it's just me. You think of kind of like a desert.
Real arid.
And it's not like that. It's actually kind of reminds me of central Washington. It's kind of a high desert, but there's a ton of foliage. I mean, tons of trees, tons of, is it pine trees, Jaime? Is that what they mainly have there?
There is. Further south, there's more pine trees, but up here it's more eucalypt trees and the hard redwood trees.
Yeah.
And then in the same place I was telling you about those stick breaks, like we'll be up there at night and you can hear, I reckon it's very close to us, probably 20 metres away, and you'll hear snap. And then we will stop and you hear us on the recorder say, did you hear that? And then we'll turn and look. And then you'll hear behind us, you'll hear another snap, and then it all goes quiet.
Yeah, very interesting how he describes, you got to see the area, Will. The area is very, he sent me pictures of it, and it reminds me of central Washington. It's not, you know, it's not the desert you think of when you think Australia. It's actually kind of like a high desert, kind of a jungle area that he's gone into.
You know, it's interesting. You talked about the snapping, you know, on different sides of them being bracketed, just like what we hear here. You know, like it's almost like they're maneuvering in position around him.
Yeah, and that's kind of the impression that he had when we had talked to him. You know, it's interesting. In Australia, they actually can't carry guns. You can get a permit for like a certain couple of days, and you can go out and hunt like wild boar or anything like that, but you can't just carry a firearm on your side for protection or for, you know, it has to be for a specific reason, which I thought was kind of fascinating and scary in the same breath that he's going up there with his family and doesn't really have a
way. Know. I mean, initially the behaviors might be benign, but then, you know, as things progress, you know, the character of that relationship could change.
And it's interesting, and I'll play the rest of the interview, but when he talked about the eye shine, you know, I had posted a video on the fan page with this, and I know you and I talked about it earlier, about these dogs going crazy, and this guy is standing out there with the light, and he's filming it with his iPhone, and it's probably, what, maybe 100 yards from him? Very, very, very creepy video.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
But it reminds me of Jaime talking about his encounter and seeing this eye shine.
Yeah, it does.
Well, let me continue with the interview here. Jaime, I wanted to ask you, since you've gone back up, so you've had one sighting of the creature when you flashed the light at it?
Yep.
And you've gone up since then. Have you had any more encounters? I think you and I talked about the chatter at one time, didn't we?
Yeah, that was that chatter I was talking about at the start. I was standing on top of rocks there, and you could hear, it was like it's really hard to explain. It's just, I couldn't understand. It was really fast. And from what I heard, it was someone telling someone to do something. It was sort of like, I don't want to do it because I'll sound like an idiot.
Just do it.
Yeah, you won't sound like an idiot.
It was just sort of like, over there. And I could sort of catch the end of it, like, over there. And I thought, that's weird. So I thought, I better call out in case it's hunters shooting pigs, because I don't want to get shot, because I'm up here by myself, and they probably think no one's here at night. But as soon as I called out, everything stopped, like, there was birds in the trees and stuff going on, and the place just went absolutely silent. And that was just really strange. And we have heard, too, late at night, we can hear the cows or just on dusk, you'll hear the cows, they moo out loud to each other when they're going home, back to where they sleep, I guess. And then we heard this cow moo, and it was like more a distress sound from the cow. And then we heard this long howl, like a, but it just went on for like 35, 40 seconds, this sound.
Like it was trying to mimic the cows?
Yeah, it was just, it just sounded wrong, but it was so strange at the same time, and it didn't resemble anything that should be up there. But it was way off in the distance. Yeah, with the sticks being broken, you'll hear the snap, and then you'll hear like a thump on the ground, and just all weird stuff like that. And last time we were up there, because I've got a night vision monocular scope, so, and it's got infrared on it. So we think every time we pull that out, we do see the ice shine. They seem to be a long further away. And we had this thing out, and first off, we're using it by hand, and it's really hard to focus. So we put it on a tripod, and it works perfect. And then it was about 10:45 at night, and we're just about packing up to go home, and I was looking through this thing at the trees down to where we always see them stand, and I seen an eye looking back at me. But the yellow, the eyes we usually see is like a yellow shine. But this eye was brown in the middle and sort of a yellowy off-white color on the background, because on my camera, it's really good up to 140 meters night vision. Like, it's really good. Whatever it was looking back at me, but this thing wasn't like the first thing I've seen. It was just complete, like a really shiny black, and had like a mullet style straight across the top haircut down, but I could only see half of its face behind the tree. And as I'm looking at it, it's like this thing smiled, and then I seen its teeth. And the one thing that stood out to me was it had perfect teeth. They were bigger than human teeth, but perfect and all square. And so I said to my mate Louis, I said, have a look at this and tell me what you see. And he's looking, and then he said, I see what you're looking at. And then he says nothing, and then he turns to me and he says, well, I think it's time that we should go home. So we packed up and went home and called that a night. And I've told people that, and that was the last time we're up there. That was only 4 weeks ago. People just, like on Thursday, I was telling someone, and the bloke just laughed right in my face. And I said, well, you can either believe me or you can't, but this is what I've seen, my mate seen it.
You know, it's interesting that you mentioned the color of the eyes. I've heard that probably now at least 20 times. And the guy last week we had on the show from New York, that's how he described it. He said their eyes really aren't white. When you look at their eyes, it's more of, they have like the brown, and then on the outside of the eyes, it's more of a yellowish,
yes.
not really white, is what he was saying. But I've heard that so many times. Well, people who've had up-close encounters with them, they'll say that their eyes really aren't white. They're more of a yellow, kind of a yellow color.
Even now telling you, it still feels unbelievable that I've seen this thing.
Kind of interesting. He talks about the yellow eye shine, or the yellow, what normally would be the white part of our eyes being kind of a yellow
right,
color.
Right, a little yellowish.
Yeah. And I know the guy last week talked about that.
Yeah, I don't think that's out of line. I mean, I look at a lot of the higher primates, gorillas and chimps are kind of like that too. So I think it's right in line with what a primate would be.
Yeah, there's a lot of little details that he has with these different encounters that it's hard to dismiss, you know what I mean?
Oh yeah, absolutely. No, it's a very good account. Lots of great details. And like I said, I was listening to all the different particulars of behaviors and things, and I was just going, there's one, and thinking of all the different accounts here that match right up, right exactly with those.
The last part of the interview is where he talked about taking his family up there camping, and it's about five minutes left of the interview, but I wanted to play it for you to hear some of the behaviors and get your take on it.
But when we went back and camped there, we've walked up this track, and then we got chased by the wild horses. They're called Brumbies up there, and these horses chased us for 45 minutes and had us pinned, and every time we tried to move, the horse would run straight at us and snort and throw its head and kick, and it was running around, just had us trapped. And then we finally got out of there, and I thought that was strange, but the whole time this is going on, I kept saying to my wife and kids, look around to see if anything's watching us. And even my wife, she's a skeptic, and she says, I couldn't see anything, but I could feel it.
Hmm.
We finally got away from them, got back to camp, cooked our dinner, waited, the sun went down, then we're all just sitting around the campfire, just being outside, because my kids, that's the first time they've ever been camping, and they're just throwing sticks in the fire, having fun, and we're talking. And my wife and my daughter went to bed about 8:30, and because I don't drink, my wife had a few beers, and she was in the tent, and she was snoring. About another hour goes past, and we're sitting there, and my son goes, well, I'm going to go to bed, Dad, and said, no, I'd prefer if you stayed up with me, mate, because I don't like sitting here by myself. And then he went to get up, and then we heard a growl, like behind our tent, probably 20 metres away is where the bush track starts, so we're sort of back right onto the bush. And he says, did you hear that, Dad? And I said, yeah, I did, but don't worry about it, mate, it's nothing. And then I went and got the spotlights out, and then we looked in the bush, and then 50 metres away, we see these yellow eyes crouching down at the top of the grass level, which is probably 5 foot, just staring at us. And I said, there they are, mate. And he goes, yeah, I know, that's that bloody thing again, isn't it? And he's going, I'm going to bed, I'm not staying here. So he went to bed and I stayed up, and then I looked again and it was gone. So then I stayed up till all the firewood was burnt, and then I put water on the fire, put it out, and went to bed. And we took our little puppy, we got a Jack Russell puppy, and he was only like 10 weeks old. So he was in the tent and he was whinging. By this time it was about 1 o'clock in the morning, and it just started to just rain, and then so I took him outside because I thought he wanted to do a wee. So I took him out, come back in, and then I'm laying there in bed. I couldn't sleep because I knew that something was in the bush watching us. And then I'm laying there, and I must have dozed off, and I wake up, and it was like, I think, 2:15 in the morning. I'm laying there, and I could hear something hitting the tent on the roof above us, and I'm telling myself, you're only freaking yourself out. It's just sticks blowing and falling out of the trees and landing on the tent. And then I laid there for another 20 minutes and I thought to myself, well, sticks don't fall in the one spot continuously. They were all hitting in the same spot on top of the tent. So I've got out to have a look around, couldn't see anything. And then I went back in and it happened again. And I've just thought, I was actually a bit concerned because I had my family and that, and I'm thinking, what are you doing? What? I've got my kids here, my wife's here. This is just crazy. So I woke everyone up, told them what I thought was going on, and I said, we're going home. I said, pack up everything, get in the car. So I made the kids go sit in the car, lock the doors, and me and my wife packed everything up. Took us about an hour. And then when we got back in the car, my wife turns to me and says, could you hear that? She goes, I could hear something banging two sticks together when you were rolling the tent up. I said, well, why didn't you tell me? She goes, well, you looked like you just wanted to get out of there, so I didn't mention it. Yeah, that was our camping trip there.
That's crazy.
I guess they got their way, huh?
Yeah, I guess, yeah, it was just a scare tactic thing, but the whole time, every time something new happens, I keep thinking in my head, this is not real. Like, how can this be happening? It's not real. But now I'm a firm believer. I'll tell people. I don't try and convince people. I just tell them of what I've seen and heard. And I say, if you want to believe it, you can, but 9 times out of 10 people start mocking you and laughing and this and that. And then I'll turn around and say, well, if it's such a joke, how about I take you up to where I've seen this happen and I'll show you.
And they won't go with you, will they?
One person has accepted my offer.
That's right. Well, good for you, Jaime.
You know, I wanted to thank Jaime for coming on the show and sharing his encounter. The guy is just one tough SOB, you know what I mean, Will?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, this guy's not scared of anything. He can't go up there with a firearm. He takes his family up there camping. He's seen these creatures in the area. I mean, he's a full-blown addict, you know, as far as...
That's pretty gutsy.
Yeah, it's very gutsy, man. You know, maybe they make him tougher in Australia than they do in the U.S. I don't know. But,
well, you know, I remember when I was in the Army and the Australian troops, you know, we got a chance to meet a lot of our allied soldiers. And they were some tough customers, let me tell you. I was very thankful to have our Australian friends as allies.
Yeah. God help us if we ever go to war with Australia, huh?
That's right. No, very, very tough, great people, you know.
Jamie's like Clint Eastwood, man. He'll just go up there, you know, unarmed and take his family up. And, you know, he's seen the creatures up there. He knows they're up there. Tough, tough guy and very cool. And I wanted to thank him for sharing his encounter with us. Definitely.
Yeah, he has an awesome, awesome story there.
Yeah, very cool. What do you think about it throwing stuff on his tent? Kind of remind me of Mine Zinsky's encounter.
Yeah, yeah, I think it kind of goes along with the rock throwing a little bit and the throwing sticks. You know, just like chimps, you know, they'll throw things. You know, it's one of those primate characteristics. It's not something that we should think as a surprise because primates do this kind of stuff.
Yeah, interesting encounter. He's going up there next week, and you know, I wish him luck. I gave him a warning not to. Get too comfortable with the benign behavior that's going on, that things can turn pretty quick. But
no, I think so. You're exactly right, because that you know, the character of that behavior could change suddenly. You know,
yeah.
If they're in the wrong mood or he does something wrong, you know, in their eyes it could change very drastically.
Yeah, he's Australian though. He'll probably be okay.
Yeah, he'll throw something back at him. You know, tell him to bugger off. You know.
Yeah, never mess with an Australian, I guess.
That's right.
But no, I really wanted to thank him again for coming on the show and sharing his encounter. And I'll be posting that full video to the Bigfoot Hotspot Radio fan page on Facebook. And, you know, you can get to all of the... It's about an hour-long interview that we did with him. And it's just a really interesting... You know, he talked a lot about tree structures he's seen. He's seen the different, you know, we had talked about the X's at the Browns property. You know, the trees seem to form an X. And he said he had seen that in a few spots. And right up to where he camps, he had seen broken trees, like snapped off limbs, almost leading right to where he camps. So he's seen a lot of things, man. And that hair was ridiculous. I'm going to have to, as soon as I get done editing and I post that video, you'll have to check out that hair, man. It is the craziest thing I've ever seen.
Yeah, I'll take a look. I already knew from the description you gave me. It does sound like what I've seen myself, but yeah, I'll be fascinated to see it.
Well, next on the show, we have Doug. And Doug kind of had an interesting encounter where he heard what we call the samurai chatter. But I wanted Doug to go through and talk about his encounter and talk about what happened. And I wanted to welcome Doug to the show.
Hi, Doug. How are you this evening?
Hey, I'm doing good.
Well, Wes and I talked a little bit about your encounter, but the first thing is just tell us what you knew about the subject prior to the incident happening.
My brother actually was pretty heavily into the subject and would talk to me about it and stuff like that, and show me pictures, a few videos and stuff like that, but I never really... didn't think it held much weight, you know, wasn't anything I was too interested in myself. that's pretty much it. Seems, you know, I've seen a few videos.
You didn't really think too much of the subject.
No, no, not really.
Okay, so what were you doing prior to the MN?
I was actually just hanging out at my uncle's house, which is where I was staying at the time, renting out a room from him, and I just got done eating some lunch. It was about 12:30, something like that in the afternoon, and I decided to go take a walk, a place where my sister had told me about, who actually lived at the time right behind uncle on our family's property. So I was, just, you know, trying to go out and get a little bit of solitude. I just moved back to North Carolina from Athens, Georgia. And I'd just gotten out of a relationship and going through some hard times. So I was just going to get a peace of mind, walk out in the woods by myself, time to myself. Decided to go take a walk to this waterfall that my sister told me about. That's on a bigger creek. There's actually a smaller creek that runs along the side of the house I was staying at the time, my uncle's house, and it runs into a bigger creek that has, like, smaller cascading waterfalls and stuff like that. Very pretty. I had not been out there before, so I decided to take a walk out there. To get there, you have to cross this smaller creek and go through, like, a patch and cross a cow pasture. There's a bunch of cow out there. So I walk into the woods. After crossing the creek, you got to hop over a barbed wire fence. And as soon as I walk into the woods, I start kind of hearing this hammering sound, which I thought was hammering. So I walk through this little section of woods into pasture area, walk across the pasture, and I'm still hearing this noise. And from the section of woods over where the bigger creek is that I was heading towards, so it's a little bit further away. It wasn't, like, right beside me at this point. And it was kind of, it wasn't repetitive like a hammering, though. It struck me as odd, because it was like a bang, a bang, 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 bang. So I walk over and cross this big pasture area, and I cross into the next section of woods that lies on the other side, walking towards this creek. I decide to kind of take a right. When I get into the woods, there's like a little path, ATV trail. Owners of the property use to go up and down, and I guess, you know, put hay out and whatever for cows or, I don't know, farming stuff. And this noise is still going on from my right in a patch of woods, and it's really loud at this point. And I'm trying to figure out what this is. I'm starting to get a little freaked out. So I'm thinking, you know, maybe it's a woodpecker or something like that, but it wasn't like fast, like woodpeckers do, you know?
Right.
And so I turned to walk towards the noise just to see if I could see a woodpecker or anybody there. And as soon as I turned to walk towards the noise, about maybe 50 feet or so in front of me, there's like a hill, and it's this sound comes from like right over, like pops me in my tracks, and I just kind of freeze, like paralyzed, you know, with fear. And it started out kind of sounding like, I don't really know how to explain it, and then the tone sort of shifted, and it sounded more like a sort of like, I guess, like it, I thought Tasmanian devil sound sort of, but it was kind of higher pitched, and it didn't really sound that big, but it was enough to scare me because I'd never heard anything like that before.
Doug, did it sound anything like this?
Somewhat, but it sounded not as like big sounding. It wasn't so guttural. It was more of like a higher pitched, like higher tone than that. But it's kind of similar to that. Which okay. After, like, you know, when you're out by yourself in the woods, just going to hang out and get a peace of mind, and this happens, it's kind of a terrifying moment, you know. I've been in a few pretty bad car wrecks, and you know how, I don't know if you've ever been in a car accident or anything, that like your adrenaline just shoots up to like a high level and seems like time sort of slows down a little bit.
Right. Right.
So that's sort of the feeling, well, that's the exact feeling that I had, which, you know, being out in the woods by yourself is extremely scary. But I, for some reason, I had my phone on me, and there's actually a cell phone tower at the top of the pasture there, so that's a service. But I reach in my phone, and my first reaction is to call my brother, who's working with his father-in-law at the time, pretty much just to let somebody know that I was alone out there, and there was like a, sounded like an animal was about to be attacked, or I didn't really know. It was just my first reaction to do that. And so I call him as this is happening, well, like right after it happens, and I'm kind of backing away slowly from this, and I didn't see anything, but I did, and the knocking was still going on, and then there was other knocking going on from another section, like down closer to the creek area. So I'm just kind of freaking out. So I call him, and I'm kind of backing away and, you know, turn around and start walking faster and faster, slowly coming to my wits, back into the pasture so I could see everything around me. And I'm talking to him and telling him what had happened and explained to him, like, tried to make my best impression of what it sounded like and that there was, like, this crazy banging noise going on and there was nobody else out there. Sort of, you know, I was kind of giving the rundown of what was going on. And he just automatically was like, dude, I think that you just witnessed or are around like Bigfoot or Sasquatch or something. I was like, no. You know, I just assumed it was strictly like something that happened up in like the Pacific Northwest from like stuff that he told me. I didn't realize it was something that had happened all over the United States.
What part of the country is this in?
This is in North Carolina, and the Piedmont area of North Carolina. Actually, like, okay. If you drive about 40 miles or so, 45 miles, you'd be in, like, Asheville, North Carolina, which is up in the Appalachians. And then that's up where the Pisgah National Forest is and Cherokee National Forest is, like, a whole lot of just open mountain woods not too far away. And the fact that you could follow like this creek is called Drowning Creek actually, and it runs into the Catawba River, which is also actually only about 5 or 6 miles away from where I was living at the time at my uncle's house. And there's like a big lake, Rotis Lake, and a dam and everything over there. So there's like, a big body of water and a lot of wood. Yeah, so he tells me to, you know, try to get a picture or something, and I'm just like, this is too much for me right now. Like, we'll just walk back towards it and see if you can see anything. So I'm on the phone with him. I'm like, all right, man, stay on the phone. And I start walking back towards where it all happened. And as soon as I start doing that, there's just like a bang, 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 just really aggressive banging, sounding like somebody just smacking a tree as hard as they can with something. And at that point, I'm just like, okay, screw this. Turn around and jet home. Like, you know, just run as fast as I can back to the house. As soon as I get back across the creek and up to my uncle's house where my sister was living, she was pulling in for her lunch break. And so I, like, right after it happened, I talked to my brother, and then I told my sister what had just happened. And she didn't really know how to take it. Like, she thought that she was like, well, maybe it was like had a coyote or something, because there are coyotes out there. And it's like, well, maybe it was just like a wild pig or something. I was like, no, there's no pigs up there. Like, well, you sure it wasn't a cow or something? I was like, dang, I know. Like, these crazy banging noises going on. But she was just like, well, just calm down and, you know, I'm going to go take my lunch break and whatever. She just kind of wrote it off, you know, I guess not really knowing how to react. She could see that I was like distressed, and she was like, well, just go grab a beer or something and chill out, you know. But she takes a lunch break, leaves, whatever, and my brother actually comes home about an hour later, and he convinces me to walk back down into the edge of the woods that's right by my house, not all the way back to where we went, because I was too scared to go back out there. But and he walks down, he's like, all right, watch this, man. Picks up the stick and just whacks the tree really hard. And he's like, just hold on a second, listen. And sure enough, man, there was a knock that came back from, it sounded like it was a lot further away, like whatever was out there had kind of scooted its way back up the creek further away from or maybe it was just, you know, another one further away, not back. I'm not really sure. But the first experience, later on that night, too, my brother and I and went over to my sister's house, and I was kind of telling them, giving them the rundown of what had happened. And my brother was like, yeah, and actually knocked on a tree after you left and, you know, heard something knock back. And he was just, like, thrilled when I was just, you know, still kind of in shock. He was just really excited. Right. So I actually moved back down to Athens, Georgia for about another year, a year and a half or something like that. And I was right around here because when I moved back, because I had moved back to Georgia and then came back to North Carolina to stay at that same house again. And it was actually around this time of year that all this was going down and all this happened. And the same time of year when the second encounter or experience happened. It wasn't really an encounter for me, but my little brother had recently turned 21, and he and his friend wanted to come down and hang out and build a fire up at my sister's house. And she's got like a chimney and like a little patio area in the back. And so we decided to hang out, have a few beers, and, you know, have a fire. I went down to the edge of the woods where we have like this brush pile and was gathering some, you know, sticks and stuff to start the fire. And decided to clack a couple of them together just out of curiosity, see if I could hear anything, get back. And while I was down in Georgia, you know, I didn't really think about any of the on that had happened, you know, just because I was playing music and just doing a whole bunch of other stuff, not really thinking about Bigfoot at all. But when I came back, I was like, oh, yeah, dude, that was a terrifying experience and pretty crazy. Let's see if I can, you know, hear something again, you know, just out of, I guess, a little bit of liquid courage or something on that. But so I hit little sticks together or whatever and nothing back, so I don't really think anything of it. I'm like, oh, well, whatever. Walk back up, see my brother and his friend are, like, running low on beer, so I walk back into the house to grab a couple more beers and noticed that my bedroom window was still open from earlier in the day, and it was starting to get chilly, so I went over to close it. When I walked up to the window, as soon as I walked up to the window, I heard this crazy sound, like crazy scream. Like it started out, sounded like tires squealing, like, you know, just hitting your brakes and or somebody spinning the tires. And then it turned into like a, from that it went to like a howl. Like a long, elongated howl, and then down to like a real deep guttural, like, whoa. But it lasted for what seemed probably like 30 seconds or something, because I kept thinking, it was like, as it was happening, it's like, is this going to end? Like, it's just gone on so long. And I just kind of froze and was like, what the hell was that, you know? And then as soon as it stopped, it was just quiet. And then I hear my brother and his friend, so my window's still open, I hear him, going, what was that? And his friend's like, I don't know, man, I don't know. So I run back outside and run up to the chimney where they're at, and they're just, like, losing it. They're like, what was that, dude? I was like, so y'all heard that, too? And they're like, yes, we heard that. It sounded like a monster, dude. It sounded like a demon. And I was like, yeah, dude, I don't know what that was. Like, it was scary, I knew that. And my sister actually comes up. This was probably about 11, 11:30, and she'd already gone to bed. She comes up and lifts up her window, and she's like, what was that, guys? She's like, y'all are freaking out. What's going on? She's like, was it a car crash? I was like, no. Because she had heard it, too, from the house. I mean, you could have heard this thing. I'm sure the neighbors had to have heard it. I didn't ask any of them. But it was just so loud and long and, like, just terrifying. It did. It sounded like a monster, like, and that could only be created through, like, some sort of computer software or something. It's like nothing that I've ever heard before. But that was the second thing that happened. And from my window, this thing sounded like it was right at the edge of the woods. That's probably only maybe 100 feet away or so. So now, not only had something happened while I was by myself, you know, I was still feeling like that was something that had, I was still, like, questioning my sanity or something like that just because it was so out of the world, like, weird. But that solidified my doubt and my denial, I guess, when my brother and my sister heard it too. And we didn't see anything. There was no banging or knocking that night. But after that, I stopped going down into the woods just because, you know, I didn't really want to run into whatever that was. It almost seemed like just threatening us or something, like stay out of our area.
Yeah, that could definitely cause an underwear changing moment to run into something I don't want to see.
Heck yeah, man. Now, I actually was talking to my brother earlier because I told him that y'all were going to have me on the show. He listened to y'all too. He's pretty stoked about it. And he ran into my cousin Mark, who actually lives in the house right up the way, right up the road a ways. And he's got a bunch of property back through there too. But he said that he was walking his dog. This was just like a couple of days ago. He said he was walking his dog up the road at night, like right at dusk. And he said he heard two growls come from the woods next to the road. And then his dog starts freaking out, and he hears something tear off through the woods, like making crazy noise. Like, he said it sounded big, and he got freaked out and went home. So, yeah, my brother just told me that today. And I was like, well, that's pretty odd. And, well, it also seems kind of like it's that time of year again. You know, it's the same time of year.
Yeah, it kind of supports the other things you've heard.
Yeah. Brother, I talked to him yesterday, too. He said that it sounded like something last week when he and his girlfriend were asleep. He stays in my older room now. My little brother does. He said it sounded like something was banging on the roof of the garage carport out beside the house really loud. And then he's like, thought he heard something else bang back. So those are a couple of things that recently have happened over there. So it seems like activity is kind of ramping up in that area again. Like I said, like this time of year, I don't know if they're like a family unit that just is more active this time of year, or if it's like migrating.
Have you heard any animals come up missing or anything in the area?
No. I mean, there's, like I said, there's coyotes that occasionally will come up, but if you like shoot a gun up in the air, they'll run off.
Right.
Yeah, there's, I mean, and the area is not, like, you know, it's pretty populated. I mean, it's still rural, you know, rural North Carolina. It's not city or town, right? Roads and, you know, schools and churches around the area, too, so.
I was just wondering if, now do the local people around there, would they be open to talking about things like this, or would it be something if they saw one of these things, would they keep it to themselves?
Well, I think now it would be more of a thing that people might actually say something just because of the popularity of something like Finding Bigfoot being on TV, you know?
Right.
Maybe it's more of something that they would not be scared to talk about. But I have a feeling that... Oh, good for it. I mean, it depends on the person, really, I think. Like,
sure. I was just curious if anyone in the area had said anything, you know, they'd heard or seen anything similar.
You know, like I said, I didn't talk to my cousin personally, but my brother just kind of told me that it happened to him a couple days ago with him and his dog. So
right.
That's
right.
The only other person that I know of that has experienced something like that, other than my little brother. Now, I totally forgot. We actually did go back up. My dad came down the next day after that really long, loud scream. Because he was really interested and kind of wanted to see if, you know, it was maybe coyotes or something like that. He came down, and me and him and my brother and my uncle and my other brother all walked up to the pasture, and there was actually a little calf that had been killed, and it looked like maybe some coyotes had gotten a hold of it. So I don't know if it was that noise. I don't think it could have been a coyote because it was just, it didn't sound like one at all. I've heard coyotes, but there was, you know, there was like a dead calf up in there. I don't know.
What was the condition of the calf? Did you tell how it had been killed?
The hind had been torn out. It kind of looked like it looked like coyotes had definitely been up there eating on it, but I don't know how long it had been dead. It couldn't have been but a couple of days. And honestly, my dad was just like, well, you know, animals, when they're dying, can make some pretty crazy noises. Maybe that's what you heard. And I was like, no, this is like way further up than this, where this noise came from, because this noise came from literally right at the edge of the woods,
right.
Next to the house. So, of course, you got to be skeptical, and especially if you haven't experienced anything like that yourself. And
yeah, absolutely.
you know, I try to be as skeptical as possible, but some things you just, you know, experience something and it's like there's no way around what it could be. I'm not saying I know what they are, but I really, right. After experiencing those things, you know, I definitely feel like they are real. I mean, it's not just people running around in suits and playing recordings or anything.
No, very good point.
Yeah, and be safe while you're up there, Doug. You know, I appreciate you coming on the show. I appreciate you sharing your encounter.
Yeah, sure.
But
yeah,
definitely
thank you for
be
having
safe
me.
While you're up there.
Yeah, I actually don't live there anymore. I go visit occasionally, but I live in Hickory, North Carolina, which is probably about like 30 miles away or so. And I live in a pretty heavily populated apartment area, so I don't think I'll be running into anything like that around here.
Yeah.
But yeah, I appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Yep, thank you, Doug.
All right, take it easy, guys.
Well, interesting. I mean, you know, I've heard things from that part of the country, so there's definitely activity there.
It's interesting he mentioned the chatter.
Yeah, yeah. That we're getting that more and more now, I think. You know, people are actually coming out and talking about that.
Well, I want to thank everyone for joining us tonight. And if you get a chance, check out our Facebook fan page until our website goes live. The Sasquatch Chronicles will be posting these videos up on the fan page under Bigfoot Hotspot Radio. But I wanted to thank Doug for coming on. I want to thank Jaime and Will, as always. Thank you for being here. And until next time, everyone, have a great night. You know what the worst part about laying sod is?
Probably the back part, huh?
Yeah. Actually, laying the sod is the worst part of laying sod.
Yeah, that's way too much work, man. That is.
Yeah, I spent all day laying that sod. And
oh, no, thanks.
Yeah, it wasn't fun.
It makes my back hurt just thinking about it.
The best part is when my dog went out and took a dump right on the sod I just laid. I was like, thank you. Thank you.
Of course.
What's that movie from the 70s? I was like, thank you. May I have another?
Yes. Thank you, sir. You know, that's something when I was in the Army, we used to say a lot. Thank you, sir. May I have another? Always when we were getting screwed some way, you know.